Question.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm having problems ringing up project one.
Okay.
It just won't come up. Is it because of Windows 7, or?
Project what won't come up?
The project itself.
The project is off of the book. So when you click on the project, it should give you the ability to upload a file. So.
Yes, but what file? Where's the file?
Project one is the file.
Well, project 1.0 is a, you have to go to the website where the binary numbers are, and you have to make it to level 4. And when you get
well,
to
I
level.
I got into that, but it's the 1.1 that I can't get into.
Okay, so let me show you, because the 1.1, I don't write the project, excuse me, thank you. I don't write the project on the website because I'm expecting you to have the book. So project 1.1 is at the end of chapter 1, and it's this one, identify ports on your computer. Right, so you have to look at the back of your computer or lab computer and make a diagram showing the ports. So you have to create a diagram, either on paper and then scan it and create a file, or you can do it on Microsoft Paint, you know, or if you have another application, you know, Visio, or any other application that you feel comfortable with, creating a diagram of the back of the computer and then, you know, highlighting the names of the ports. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about that today.
Can you take a picture of it?
You can take a picture of it and then you know, paste it into Microsoft Paint and then do lines and put the names of the ports on that, right? And then or in a Word document, you know, and then put it into a Word document. You have to get creative, because I want you to think, you know, professional. I want it to look professional. Right, so you do your best, right? You look for an application that works for you, that represents what you're trying to do in as clean way as possible, right? As clean way as possible. Don't make it sloppy and send it and think that that's good enough to do. Try not to do the minimum.
It has to be a desktop, right? For the project.
That's
desktop computer,
right.
Not a Mac.
Well, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter, because you're taking a picture of the back of the computer, right? Because it's a hardware, and a Mac computer should have all the connectors in the back that a regular PC would have. So that's basically it, right? So I don't type in the description of the project. I'm saying go to the book and then find the description there and take it from there.
The only thing I might.
Yeah, but the point is that you're gonna name it, right? So even if you have a FireWire connector, you would name it. So
Visio is allowed. You can use it.
Visio, you know, you may be able to use Visio, but you're gonna have to start from scratch, right?
Right.
Build all these schematics.
The laptop will work.
A laptop may work, but you have to take pictures of all the three angles, you know, because. And then name all the connectors. Ideally, a PC, so that what you're looking at is the back of the computer, and you're naming these connectors over here. You see? So I want to talk a little bit about study techniques, because
what kind of technique?
Study techniques. Have you heard of SQ3R? Who's heard of that? You heard of it?
I have.
Okay. Let me attempt. Here, I got a. I got an eraser. Let me attempt to explain what that is. And it basically stands for a few things. The S is survey, the Q is question, And the 3 R's is read, rehearse, and review. Okay? Survey question, read, rehearse, review. And this is a method of covering the material at hand, especially because the material sometimes is a lot of material, and sometimes even if it's not a lot of material, the substance of the material is quite considerable. So this book right here is put together in a way that it wants to help you follow these steps when you're trying to cover material off of the book. And if you notice how the book is put together, it will usually have a main title. Let me tell you, this is what surveying is about. The survey step in the SQ3R method of studying means that you're going to look at the material and make an assessment. You're going to survey how much material you have to cover in order to make an assessment of how long you should sit down to study for. So if it's a little bit of material, you may be able to cover the material in maybe one sitting. You sit down for a couple of hours and you may be able to cover the material. If it's if the amount of material is substantial, then you might want to, you know, manage your time and allocate 2 hours here, 3 hours here, maybe 2 hours on Monday, you know, or 3 hours on Tuesday, and, you know, 3 hours on Saturday, you know, 2 hours on Sunday, so that you chunk the material. So all you have to do is survey. And when you survey the material, what you're doing is basically maybe looking at the objectives. This chapter one, the objectives don't seem like quite much. There only seem to be two objectives. And then maybe you read the objectives, read the introduction, the title, and then if you pay attention to how it's put together, it's usually put together in this fashion. You're gonna have a title, and then you're gonna have a subtitle, and then subtitles. So you're gonna have maybe a green title, and then somewhere within that section, you're gonna have a blue subtitle, and then you're gonna have other subtitles in a slightly different color. And those titles and subtitles allow you to follow these steps. But the first thing that you need to do is survey the material. So I'm just gonna quickly look at the material, figure out how much text there is and how many pictures there are in the book. The more pictures there are, the less reading you have to do, right? So there's one title here, and that's just an introduction of the material, quick introduction. There's another main title here with a subtitle here in blue. You see that? And then if you keep going, there's another subtitle here underneath that title. There's another subtitle there, another one here. Quite a bit of pictures. There's another subtitle there, another one there. There's a lot of material, and that's it. There's mainly only two titles with maybe six subtitles, right? And it doesn't look like much reading, but the material is considerable. You may be able to cover the entire reading in one sitting, maybe two sittings. If you're familiar with computers, this may be a piece of cake, right? You read chapter one, read right through it, you know, a couple of hours at most, you cover the material, and that's it. So surveying the material, and this chapter is very small compared to later chapters. You know, when you get to chapter 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, the chapters are really long chapters with several titles, and many subtitles and subtitles.
Are you going to continue to put the chapters on the site?
For the book chapters?
Yeah.
No, I'm not allowed to do that. I put chapter one in there, that's it. Maybe chapter four, you know, to buy you more time, because chapter four is the next chapter that we're gonna cover. But you need to buy the book. Yeah, that's basically how it works. But in any case, it would be nice if I could do that, huh?
Yes.
So.
Well, I wanted it for other reasons.
I see. So the next step is question, right? How much of this material do I know? How much of this material do I feel comfortable with? What do I know about computers? So Introduction to Computers is the title of this chapter. And in order to question, begin really questioning, you might want to read the first page, right? During the questioning step, I would usually go online, look at YouTube, maybe find some videos related to the material, see, you know, and then question how much of it do I feel familiar with. If you're working with other people, with colleagues, you might want to ask questions to them. You know, what is your understanding of this topic? And then maybe begin sharing information. I haven't even done any reading yet, but I already surveyed the material, I already made an assessment of how much time I'm gonna take, you know, to sit down and cover this material. And I'm already talking to people about the material. And then the next step is you begin reading. You have to actually sit down and do your reading. And the way this is designed is that you're expected that when you get to a subtitle over here, this is a moment to stop and reflect about what you just read. This is what rehearsing is about, right? What did I just read? I just read that, you know, computers have input and output devices, and the input devices are, you know, the keyboard, the mouse, the microphone, the webcam, and so on and so forth. And that output devices are this, and that, right? If it's still not clear, then you go back to your reading. So that means that you're gonna spend quite a bit of time here in the read and rehearse. Because I'm gonna read through this subtitle all the way to here, inspect these pictures, and then rehearse. What did I just learn? Well, I just learned that, you know, connectors can be 15-pin for VGA, 3-row, right? For videographic, VGA port, right? Videographics accelerator port. Or DVI ports, you know, there are two types of DVI ports. And then, so that's the reading and rehearsing. You have to read and rehearse throughout the entire process until you make it to the end of the chapter, right? And then when you get to the end of the chapter, that's when you do your review. And the book is designed in a way that it allows you to do that by reviewing the basics, right? There's a section here called Reviewing the Basics. So you read through those questions, if possible, answer those questions, and then the thinking critically is one of my favorites. You should be able to read each and every one of these statements and feel comfortable with it. A lot of times, part of the survey can be reading the critical thinking statements. Because if I can read through each and every one of those statements and I understand everything that it says, then I may not have to do the entire reading. I can just scan through the material. But if I find, you know, statements that are not clear, then I can evaluate what information I need to go into the book and gather in order to get a good grasp on it. If you're not understanding any of the statements in the critical thinking, then you really need to manage your time so that you spend enough time in the book trying to gather as much information as possible. You know, while you're doing all of this, the book doesn't have to be your only resource, right? You come to class, you make notes, you go online, you use resources such as YouTube, right? Use YouTube. Use Webopedia. Webopedia is an online dictionary for computer terms, computer terminologies, right? So if you don't know what PCI is and you can't find it easily, you know, in the book or what have you, you go to Webopedia and then you type in PCI and it will give you the technical description of that particular term, right? use Wikipedia with caution, because, you know, this information, anybody can contribute to the information, but nowadays Wikipedia has become more you know, recognized as far as the value of its content. And then just use Google. Use Google. When you go to google.com, on the top of the website, if this is the website right here, and this is your search engine, right, it's gonna say Google right here. If you right here, there are options that you can click on so that you can browse the web here, or you can look for pictures or videos or news or a whole bunch of other things. So if I'm looking for pictures of motherboards, for example, you click on pictures and then type in motherboard and click search, and it will give you a whole range of pictures of that particular device. Or I can click on videos and just find videos related to that material. So you're using all of those tools available to you, and you're using these steps as effectively as possible. You have to have a good study technique in order to be successful. You can apply this to any class in college, you know, not just this class. But I think it's worthwhile mentioning. Any comments? No? Okay. Any questions on chapter one, the material, or anything that we talked about on Monday? No questions?
I'm a little confused about the project, actually, as far as exactly what we need to do.
Which project?
Oh, the one.
Talk to me after class, and I'll try to bring you up to speed, okay? I'm recording these lessons, and I'm going to put them up on YouTube, but you have to be patient, because uploading videos to YouTube can take quite a bit. So I'm working on that. I'm working on modifying the videos, maybe adding some captions to the video. And then I'll make them available to you. But don't rely on that 100%. You still need to be here, you know? So that's pretty much the deal. But I'm going to put the videos on there so that you can use them for review later. Okay? Any questions? No? More questions? I have a motherboard over here, and the other day we were talking about how components or peripheral devices connect to the computer, because this is basically the body or the veins, the system that carries the information from one device to another. The motherboard creates integration. The motherboard allows all the devices that entail a computer to interconnect with each other and share data using electricity, right? So we need to become familiar with all of the components on this surface and all of the connectors over here. You need to be able to visually recognize the connectors on the motherboard. And what I want to say is that everything basically connects to the motherboard. Oh, this is not going to work. And that, oh, here, I got a video card right here. No, that's not going to work either. Making me look bad. All right. So take, for example, an optical drive. Let me just do optical drive. I can connect an optical drive because this is what you see in the front of your computer, right? Mm-hmm. In the back of the optical drive, there's a connector, there's an interface. This happens to be a 40-pin IDE connector. IDE stands for Integrated Drive Electronics. We use a cable, and we'll talk more in detail about this. I just want to make a point that we use cables or connectors to allow that device to interface with the motherboard, because that device needs to send information to the central processing unit for processing. The central processing unit, in a nutshell, is like a translator that allows devices such as this one over here to take information and then send the information to a different device in a format that that device can understand. So, for example, this happens to be a serial ATA cable that connects to serial ATA interfaces or connectors on the surface of the board. Different boards have different capabilities. This motherboard happens to have the capability of supporting IDE technology, because it has at least one IDE interface, but also serial ATA technology. And it has four serial ATA connectors. And we'll talk more in detail about what those technologies mean and how they are different later on. What I want to point out is that these devices connect to the motherboard. Let me see. Come on. There you go. Because they have to share the information, or they have to communicate with the central processing unit in order for the central processing unit to take the information, convert it into a form that can be understood by this device over here, because this device doesn't necessarily store information the same way that this device does. The formatting is different, the way the information is embedded onto the surface of the physical device is different. So somebody needs to take that information from one device, convert it into a form that the other device can understand. It's almost like a translator, right? If one person wants to talk to another person, but they don't speak the same language, then a translator can come in and mediate for them. And in a nutshell, without giving you too much technical detail, which I will give you in chapter 6 about CPUs, let's agree that the central processing unit, it acts as a translator, right? It takes the information, it converts the information from one form to another, and then hands over the information to a different component, so that in a way that component can understand it, right? And it does that by sending the information through cables using electricity, you know, through the bus. You'll remember what a bus is? It's the series of traces that connect one device to another on the board. Careful with that. So, let me do this one more time.
And there it goes again.
I told you I was gonna do it one more time. So I have a mouse over here, which happens to be a serial connector. Right? So that I have a mouse right here that connects to the back of my computer. Because when you're looking at the back of the computer, the only thing that you see is these connectors over here. Everything else is inside the case, if you will. And then other things that you may see are expansion cards, or the front of the expansion cards. An expansion card, It's a card that expands the capabilities of the computer. That's why it's called an expansion card, because we are expanding the capabilities of the computer. So, for example, I can take this card right here, which uses a PCI interface. These connectors right here, these white ones, are referred to as PCI connectors. PCI stands for Peripheral Component Interconnect. I'm going to write that on the board here in a minute. But what I want to tell you is that I can insert that card right here, and this is what you will see in the back of the computer. All right? You will see these connectors over here, this connector over here, that you can connect internet to, right? I can expand the capabilities of the computer because if this sound card over here is not good enough for the purpose that I want to use this computer for, I can go to Price Electronics or Best Buy or one of those electronic stores, or you can go online to Tiger Direct or Newegg.com or whatever website that you use to buy electronic devices. And you can buy an expansion card, right? That's a sound card that has more capabilities, which uses a PCI interface so that I can put it right here on one of these PCI slots, right? And I'm doing this to point out that that I can have input my input devices connect to the back of the computer, which in turn, you know, are embedded onto the surface of the motherboard or integrated. They are part of the motherboard itself. And that these connectors and that these devices connect to each other in the following fashion. Okay, I meant to do that. Right. So all of these devices over here are I/O devices, input or output interfaces. They are interfaces. In this particular motherboard, here, let me get close to the camera so I can show this. We have these connectors over here that are referred to as PS2 connectors. All right, that's not PlayStation. That's PS2 connectors, or 6-pin mini DIN connectors. These connectors right here are usually used for a keyboard and a mouse. All right, for a keyboard and a mouse. Usually the mouse is going to be the green connector, and the keyboard is going to be the bluish connector or purple. Thank you, the purple connector. And sometimes they're not color coded. You know, they could be black or white, it doesn't matter. And you're just gonna have to look at the figure. Usually there's gonna be a figure on the plate that sits around these connectors, hugging the connectors, embedded or plugged into the body of the case in the back, and it's gonna tell you which one is the keyboard and the mouse. What we have right here is a serial connector. Serial connector uses 7 pins, and one thing that we need to keep in mind is that these connectors are defined as male or female, all right? If it has pins that are sticking out, then it's considered a male connector. If it has a plug that you plug something into, then it's a female connector. And I didn't make the rules, all right? That's just how the industry does it. All right, so this is a male connector because it has 7 pins, or 9 pins rather, that stick out. And this connector right here is used for a mouse, which you rarely see this anymore, right? This is actually old school. Maybe an old type of, you know, scanner, maybe a modem, an external modem, you know, way back in the days of America Online. You remember that? Yeah.
They're the worst.
Come on, man, they're the best. They used to be back in the day, right? I have a external serial ATA on this particular motherboard. I have USB connectors. USB stands for Universal Serial Bus. I have a couple of other USB connectors over here. I have an RJ45 connector right here. That's where you would connect your internet to, right? Or Ethernet network to. Yes, ma'am?
All of those are all called the RJ45, or do they have?
No, this one is an RJ45.
Telephone lines, different types for the same.
What do you mean? So if I'm looking at this right here.
Are they all RJ45s for the same?
For the same plug. So this is the same as this.
Right.
They're both RJ45 connectors, right?
Does the universal serial or USB, the buzz, have anything to do with the buzz or the trace
That's on the motherboard?
Well, that's a good question, and can I put a pin on that? And I'll come back to this in a minute. I'll expand on that in a minute, okay? But that's a good question. And then we have sound ports over here, or sound jacks, right? This one, that's all we got on this one. On the surface of the board over here, we have PCI connectors. These are peripheral component interconnect connectors. This one is a PCI times 16 port where you would put a video card to. These are PCI times one or by one connectors where you can put, you know, maybe a sound card, maybe a network interface card onto here. These two devices that you see here are aluminum, and what they are doing is that they are helping dissipate heat that is produced by microchips that are underneath them, right? So in essence, these are sort of a cooling system to keep the microchips that are underneath here at operating temperatures. But what you need to know is that these two microchips over here are referred to as the chipset. The two together are the chipset. If I'm saying, you know, this motherboard has chipset A35, you know, I'm talking about the combination of these two microchips. One is referred to individually, the one further away from the central processing unit, as the south bridge. This is the south bridge. The south bridge gathers information from a lot of these devices, I/O devices. So information from PCI slots go to the south bridge. Information from serial ITA connectors go to the south bridge. Information from IDE connectors go to the south bridge. USB connectors send their information through another microchip to the south bridge, and the south bridge then relays that information to the north bridge. The north bridge is the microchip that is further, closer to the central processing unit. The north bridge, depending on the type of motherboard that we're talking about, connects to memory, and it also connects to the central processing unit. All right. We have PCI slots. These are regular PCIs, PCI Express by 16, PCI Express by 1. This is the south bridge. This is the north bridge. This is the CPU socket. This is a socket. All right, and there are different types of sockets for different motherboards which fit different central processing units. And we will talk more about CPU sockets when we get there. These are my memory slots. Memory slots. This is my IDE connector. A lot of motherboards, older ATX motherboards, will have two IDE connectors. You have a battery over here that powers a microchip that performs a special function, which I want to talk about here in a minute. But it powers a microchip, probably this one in this particular case, that we refer to as the CMOS BIOS. The CMOS BIOS. And I'm going to break that down here in a minute. These are serial ATA connectors. We have some capacitors over here. Capacitors are devices that hold electricity for a certain period of time. We have some transistors riding on the surface of the board. And a transistor is a device that switches something on or off, or that it enhances a signal. I have a 24-pin ATX P1 power connector right here. This is where you would plug your power supply to, right? So this is my power supply right here. All right. And so this is what you see in the back of the computer, right? You see a power supply. You see these connectors over there. Maybe the back of expansion slots. And what's happening in the back is that you would have a connector. This connector right here is a P1 ATX connector right here. And this plugs right into here, just like that. All right, just like that. And we'll talk more in detail about these connectors. You may have a connector like this one that provides 12 volts of electricity directly into the central processing unit, just like that, right? This provides power to the computer. It provides three types of voltages, 12 volts, 5 volts, or 3.3 volts in a positive and negative form. Let's see what else. That's about all I can think of. So your job is going to be to become as familiar as possible with each and every component that I just mentioned. Because as we move forward, I'm going to break down to you the theory of how it operates. So you need to be able to recognize the device visually. You should be able to look at a motherboard and say, that's the north bridge, that's the south bridge, that's the CPU socket, that's the memory slots, that's a 40 pin. You need to remember the number of pins, by the way, on some of these connectors. And I'm gonna specify which connectors you need to remember the number of pins for. So this one is a 40 pin IDE connector, all right? Serial connectors, CMOS BIOS, South Bridge, PCI slots. It's gonna be PCI Express or AGP, depending on the type of motherboard that you're dealing with. The older type of video interfaces for motherboards were AGP connectors. And we have other devices out here that I'm gonna talk about as we move forward. Something else that I want you to pay attention to, I'm gonna pass this motherboard around, and that is that you can physically see the buses. If you're looking at the bar at the back of this board, you can physically see the traces, the individual traces and groups going from one device to another, right? So I'm gonna break down here on the board in a minute how they connect to each other. And I'm gonna pass this around. I want you to be really careful because this motherboard is very sharp, and you can easily, you know, cut your fingers if you're not careful. So when you're grabbing it, you know, grab it with the palm of your hand so that it doesn't scratch you. And be careful because it is very pointy and sharp. So here, let me start over here. Any questions on that before I break it down? On the board? Yes, ma'am.
What is the orange part again? Because this way, you know, the one that's closer to the south. You said it was the 16 something.
Let me see. All right, that's PCI by 16. I'm going to write that down on the board in a minute. So let me erase this. Let me erase this. So, in essence, what you're looking at is. Doing that. All right. If this is your board, okay, this right here is your south bridge. Your south bridge is connected to your north bridge. Together, they form what we refer to as a hub. They work together. The north bridge connects you to the central processing unit. This is your CPU. The north bridge also connects you to random access memory. All right, random access memory. This is memory that holds information while the computer is running. Only while the computer is running. Okay, there are different types of memories, but random access memory is primary memory that holds data only while the computer is on. And as you mentioned a second ago, it's volatile. It's volatile. Let me write that down. Because when you turn the power off, the information dissipates. Volatile is a word that derives from the Latin word volare, which means to fly. So you could visualize that when you turn the computer off, the information flies away, right? That's what volatile means. Non-volatile would mean that it doesn't fly away, that it stays. it stays in place, right? So we have memory that is volatile, and we have memory that is non-volatile. Random access memory is considered primary memory. So if I say to you primary memory, I'm talking about random access memory, as opposed to what we may have here. If I have an IDE controller here, IDE, this may connect me to a hard disk drive. All right? The information that we store on here is non-volatile. You can turn the computer off, you can remove the hard drive, right? This is what I'm drawing over here. This is what you're looking at. Basically, this hard disk drive with this cable connecting to an IDE. You see that? Okay. In any case, what I want to point out, and to answer your question, we have different buses on the motherboard, and each bus has a different name, right? So this bus right here will be my IDE bus. You see? From here, I may have a microchip that manages my USB connectors, right? So that this bus right here is my USB, universal serial bus. You see? Mm-hmm. Right? This is my IDE bus. This bus right here that connects you from the North Bridge to the CPU is referred to as the main bus. Also is referred to as the front bus. Also is referred to as the system bus. There any other name?
No.
So this is where sometimes with computers it gets a little bit confusing, right? Because let me get a little closer. Because sometimes we use different names for the same thing, right? Hold on a second. This bus right here will be my memory bus.
Never mind.
Right? And then I may have a bus right here. This is my video. This is my video bus next to my North Bridge. You see that? Mm-hmm. No, and my PCI, let me erase this because this may lead to confusion. All right. These are my PCI slots. So notice that PCI connectors relate information to my South Bridge. USB devices relate information to the South Bridge, right? IDE interfaces relate information to the South Bridge, right? So I may even have serial ATA connectors here, which is a different type of interface than this that can perform the same function but with faster speeds, right? It's one of the newest technologies that allows a device to connect to the motherboard and relay the information at a faster speed than your regular IDE, or also known, IDE is also known as ATA, or rather PATA, PETA. This is PETA, this is SETA. This is parallel, this is serial. So this is the outline that we have. Now it gets a little tricky because the motherboard that I'm passing around, if you pay attention to the back of the board on where the buses are going, the buses are not necessarily connected in this fashion. But for educational purposes, let me say right now that I need you to learn this outline. When we talk about motherboards, in chapter 4 or 5 and 5, we'll talk about different outlines and the reasons as to why. So what I want to point out is that there's also a CMOS BIOS right here. The CMOS BIOS is a microchip that performs a particular function, and this microchip is powered by the quarter-sized battery, right? Quarter-sized battery. So this will be my PCI connectors. Yes, sir.
Do you
Yes, ma'am.
Is the system clock also used with that same battery, or is there another battery?
Right, right. The system clock is something that I need to talk about here in a minute, all right? Let me get to the system clock. Let's put a pin on the system clock for now, because I need to break that down for you in a way that you can comprehend. All right. So let me write this over here. We'll put it in the parking lot for now, okay? I'll come back to it.
Is the SATA on its own bus?
It's on its own bus.
Okay.
Connected to the South Bridge. So CMOS stands for complementary metal oxide semiconductor. And usually you're gonna see it written as CMOS BIOS. And BIOS stands for basic input output system. All right? So CMOS BIOS is an acronym for complementary metal oxide semiconductor, basic input output system. Okay? And the CMOS BIOS, this is what I want to talk about here. I want to move forward. Is there any questions or comments? Anything you want to contribute or add to this before I move on? I need to talk about the CMOS BIOS, and then we'll talk about the system clock if we have time. If not, it's going to have to happen. No? Okay. You know, the book on chapter one only briefly touches on the CMOS BIOS. But in order for anyone to have a good understanding of its function, you need to have a breakdown of it. So let me attempt to give you a breakdown of the functions of the CMOS BIOS, because the CMOS BIOS is one of the most important microchips on the motherboard. The CMOS BIOS performs an operation that we refer to as POST, or power on self test. Let me write that here. POST stands for power on self test. POST is done by CMOS. POST is done by the CMOS BIOS. Power on self test is performed by the complementary metal oxide semiconductor. And what that means is that the CMOS BIOS stores information in its memory about the specifics or the specifications of components that are connected to that particular computer. So if I have a Hitachi hard disk drive with 250 gigabytes of space, serial number 39786H57699AB something something something, right? The CMOS BIOS creates a list or an inventory of all the components that are connected to the motherboard. The CMOS BIOS knows the capacity of this hard disk drive, all right? It knows the capacity of RAM. If you have 1 gigabyte of RAM or 2 gigabytes of random access memory, the CMOS BIOS is going to record that's how much capacity you have for that particular device. It knows the type of CPU that you have. If you have an Intel, you know, i7, iCore 7 with, you know, 3.0, you know, gigahertz of speed and I don't know, you know, 2 megabytes of cache memory inside, so it knows all the capacities. It knows the type of programming that it contains. If you have any PCI devices connected on there and that are functioning, it's going to acknowledge that those devices are functioning.
Isn't that just called configuration? Knowing all that, what it's doing, the capacity?
Well, right. Yeah, but I'm trying to break it down, right? So it knows the configurations of, well, it knows the configurations, but it also gives you the ability to change those configurations, right? Because the CMOS, with the CMOS BIOS, I have the ability to access its programming, right, by clicking on certain combination of keys when you're turning on the computer. You can have the ability to access the programming here and make changes to the CMOS BIOS. And the CMOS BIOS may have the ability, for example, to turn on or off USB interfaces, right? I can turn it on, I can enable it or disable it. I can enable or disable IDE controllers. I can enable or disable serial ATA controllers, all that. But the point that I want to make is that the CMOS BIOS keeps an inventory of every device that is connected to the computer. And when you turn the computer on, okay? Or let me back up a little bit. When you turn the computer off, it remembers, all right? What specifications each and every component have, because the battery right here powers the microchip when the computer is off, okay? So that when you turn the computer on, the CMOS BIOS detects that you have pressed the power button, and then it goes, oh, I have to wake up everybody. He goes, okay, everybody, wake up. You the hard disk drive? Yeah, you are. You're Hitachi, right? 250 gigabytes, you're still good. Serial number 397864-5769AB. Okay, you're good. Can you conduct a self-check? And then you hear the hard disk drive go bzzz. Because it's testing its internal components. It's basically, the CMOS BIOS wakes up the component and say, hey, wake up, test yourself. And then the hard disk drive begins doing this, right? Yeah, I'm good, I'm ready to go, right? And it wakes up, you know, the CPU, it wakes up RAM, and it says, hey, you're still 2 gigabytes, right? And you're from Brand Maxter something, or Kingston this and that, model number such and such. Yes, can you run a self-check? And RAM runs a self-check. CPU runs a self-check. It goes to the optical drive, and then you see the light blinking, and then you hear noises, right? Bzz, bzz, because the CMOS BIOS has just told that device to check itself. So it spins the motor, you know, spins the linear motor, it makes sure that everything is functioning, and then it reports back to the CMOS BIOS and it says, I'm good, everything is working, all systems up and running, right? It goes to the floppy disk drive, if you have one, and you hear the light blinking and bzz, 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 you hear noises, right? And the computer hasn't shown you much, maybe a black screen, you know, on the monitor.
Maybe the video card saying like what type of video card,
when
the monitor turns on.
Exactly.
Like with mine, it says
NVIDIA.
So when
you install drivers, it remembers. It'll save all the settings. It'll save all the BIOS and just gives it a little bit of an update as far as like, oh, you just added something new.
Right. Actually, it depends, right? Let me tell you, the CMOS BIOS contains standard drivers for basic functionality. So keyboard maybe mouse. Although today's CMOS BIOS have much more capability, and they might have the capability of storing multiple drivers for multiple devices. Because if I click on F2 during the power on self test mode, my operating system hasn't even kicked in yet, right? And the computer needs a way to interface with that keyboard through a driver. You see?
Yeah.
So the CMOS BIOS has the capability
of
content. Right, so basic I/O drivers for basic I/O devices, for basic functionality, right? And that's why you can operate the keyboard even if your computer haven't kicked in. Now, Hold that thought, I got a whole bunch of hands up, but hold for a minute, let me finish giving you this. When the computer is running power on self-test and you need functionality, it's gonna use the drivers that are in here. Once the operating system kicks in, then it releases that driver and it allows the operating system to take over, if you will. The point that I want to get to is that the CMOS BIOS runs power on self-test. And that once it's done checking all the components, it begins looking for what we refer to as the master boot record, or MBR, the master boot record. The master boot record, I'm not going to talk in detail about the master boot record today, but let me say that the master boot record contains all the details that the computer needs, you know, in order to continue the boot up process, and that the master boot record is found on the first track and first sector of the surface of the hard disk drive. So that the CMOS BIOS, so this is important, I'm hammering this because I'm going to test you on this, okay? The CMOS BIOS performs post. Power on self-test is the process that the CMOS BIOS performs when the computer is turning on, okay? The CMOS BIOS is referred to as, check this out, the CMOS BIOS uses a type of memory that is ROM. ROM stands for read-only memory, But it's not just ROM. It used to be, back in the day, that if you bought a computer, you could go to Radio Shack and buy the latest version of your CMOS BIOS that had the newest, you know, additions to the programming, maybe fixes to, you know, problems that that particular model had been facing. You could go to the store and you could buy at Radio Shack for maybe, you know, $50 or so. A new CMOS BIOS for your computer. So you bring it home, you pop the computer open, hopefully you unplug the electricity, right? You will have a tool that still today comes in toolkits, right? And, yep. Right, a chip puller, so you pull the microchip out and then you put the new microchip in there, right? Then you boot up your computer and then pray that it will work, right? So nowadays that's not the case. Nowadays you don't, you know, if your CMOS BIOS, if your manufacturer of your computer or your CMOS BIOS in specific has a new release of programming for that microchip, all you do is you download the program from the website, and then you follow the instructions for the installation of that programming into your CMOS BIOS. This is the process that we refer to as flashing the BIOS, right? So flashing the BIOS. Because you can do that because BIOS uses a type of memory that is read-only memory. It's not volatile because here, this is where it's going to get a little confusing, right? Well, you can change it in the sense that, and that's why we have a battery, right? To remember the changes that you make. Because when you get a CMOS BIOS from the factory, it comes with some settings already embedded in the microchip that don't need a battery to remember the settings, right? Those settings are referred to as default settings. Now, if I go into the CMOS BIOS and I change the settings, right? Now it needs the battery to remember the changes that I made. You see? Once I made changes to the CMOS BIOS settings, now they are referred to as custom settings. You see? So when you have a newly born CMOS BIOS and you just embedded the the software, let me refer to it as software for educational purposes. I'm going to fix that later, so don't miss any episodes of the CNIT 103 class. But the settings on that microchip are referred to as default settings. Now, the moment I access the settings and I make changes to the settings, now they're custom settings, okay? But what I want to say, back to flashing the BIOS, is that the type of memory that allows me to do that is referred to as EEPROM, right? So EEPROM. EEPROM stands for electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. Read-only memory means that I can put the information on there one time, and then I don't have to, and then you can only read it, right? The only way to change it is if you electrically erase it, right? Which means that we flashing the BIOS, when you're flashing the BIOS, you're basically applying a certain amount of electricity, right, to the CMOS BIOS area of memory, and then that erases it. Once everything is erased, you can reprogram it. So it's electrically erasable, programmable, read-only memory. That's the type of memory. Now the book, you know, this is where it gets a little confusing, right? Because I think the book refers to it as CMOS RAM. Right?
Right.
CMOS RAM. Well, perhaps we need to understand what the word RAM means. Random access memory. What is the opposite of random access memory?
ROM.
No. Mm-mm. Let me venture to say that the opposite, and let me venture to say that arguably, okay? Because there's always an expert out there, especially since this video is going on YouTube. There's somebody that knows better, right? Let me venture to say, all right, that the opposite of RAM is SAN. Okay? SAN. SAN stands for sequential access memory. Sequential access memory. This doesn't have to do necessarily with, or this right here, this word doesn't have to do with how, with whether the information is volatile or non-volatile, but rather rather how we access the information, right? Rather how we access the information. It doesn't have to do with whether it's volatile or not. ROM has to do with whether it's volatile or not. ROM means that it's not volatile, that it stays right there. You put the information on there and it's a read-only memory. You can only read, you can't change it, right? If you put information on a CD, right? Music CD, that's why it's referred to as CD-ROM. Because it's read-only memory. It's information that's been put on that device and it's ROM. You put it on your DVD and it only reads. You can't really write on it unless, you know, you have a specific equipment for that particular purpose. So let me venture to say that SAN is the opposite of RAM, because if you all remember VHS? You remember music tapes?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you remember those? You had basically a tape where if I have 10 tracks, maybe 10 songs in this tape, in order to get to song number 9, I would need to play song number 1 first and then song number 2, because I had to go in sequence in order to access the information that I wanted to access, right? That's sequence access memory, which is different to random access memory, right? Random access memory is more of a grid. If I have a grid right here, right? If I put information here and I put information here, I don't have to go in sequence. This is RAM. I don't have to go in sequence. I don't have to go here, then here, then here, then here in order to get here. I can just randomly go to that place. I can go here, I can go here, I can go here. You see that? As opposed to sun, right? So I can say, right? I can say then that my CMOS BIOS is ROM in the sense that it's read-only memory, right? I put the information on there and it stays there. You know, you can just read off. That's what the default settings are big time ROM, right? The custom settings can be volatile because if I remove the battery, then my custom settings go away, right? But it's CMOS RAM because it has to do with the way we access the information in that microchip. It's random. It's placed in random places, and we can go to specific spots. We can go to specifics. Are you here for CNIT 106?
Yes.
Can you wait outside, please?
Okay.
And if somebody tries to come in, tell them not to come in here until I dismiss the class.
All
thank
right.
you. Sorry about that. So I wanted to clarify that because I know that I was reading chapter one and it says CMOS RAM, and it, you know, unless you have an understanding of what the acronym really means, then it's difficult to decipher exactly why in one instance it refers to the CMOS BIOS as ROM and in the other instance it refers to it as RAM. And if you think that one is the opposite of the other, then that's where the confusion kicks in, right?
So your boot up then would be sand, because it's always the same boot up sequence every time.
Well, no, because
your BIOS.
Yeah, no, because this has to do with how you access data,
okay.
Right? RAM has to do with the method of accessing the data, right? Now when we say boot sequence, and good thing that you brought that up, you reminded me. So let me give you this, and then we'll call it a day, and we'll touch base on the system clock on Monday, first thing in the morning, okay? But the CMOS BIOS also, when it's looking for the master boot record, right? You can create a sequence, what we refer to as a boot sequence, which can be changed. Right? If I press on F2 or delete or escape, depending on the type of motherboard that I'm working with, to access the programming in my CMOS BIOS, I can change the sequence. And usually the sequence is going to be floppy disk drive. By the way, FDD stands for floppy disk drive. Then it's going to be my CD-ROM. Then it's going to be my hard disk drive. You should be familiar with these acronyms, by the way. FDD is floppy disk drive, CD-ROM is CD-ROM, compact disk, read-only memory, and HDD is hard disk drive. I can change the boot sequence in my CMOS BIOS, and if you're taking CNIT 103L, who's taking CNIT 103L? Okay, you should be working on some of these labs, you know, in the next few days on accessing the CMOS BIOS, you know, looking at the data, making changes to it. Now, don't go home and access the CMOS BIOS and make changes to it, and then break your computer and blame me for it. All right, it's all on you. It's you. Any questions? We got 2 minutes. Questions or comments? Yes,
when are you gonna have this up on YouTube?
I'm uploading right now. I'm formatting right now the ones that I recorded the other day. I was only able to upload the first lesson for 106. It's already up and running.
When it's starting to boot up really, really slow, what's going on?
Well, it could be a number of things. But usually a slow boot up process could be in the operating system itself. It could be in the operating system itself, and not necessarily in the hardware area. Well, not if she's booting up, so it could be a better operating system. Yeah.
Why do we need a battery?
Even if you take that off, they stay.
We need a battery to right. Well, the new CMOS BIOSes that we're coming out with are going to be more sophisticated. I'm not sure if they're not going to have a battery. But the reason why we need a battery here is to remember the custom settings.
Yeah,
to make it work.
And then you should remember.
Yeah.
But you still need. Yeah. But here's the thing too. Yeah. It needs to remember the time of day.
That's right.
You should remember the time of day. And I'll touch base on that on Monday. Have a great week.
Yes, yeah.
Thank you too.
I'm just wondering.